Hey, what's up everybody, and welcome back to That Triathlon Show, the podcast presented by scientifictriathlon.com. I'm your host Michael, and this episode is Q&A number 123. Before we get into today's question, big thanks to our sponsors. First, we have Zen8 that you can find on zen8swimtrainer.com. They make an indoor swim trainer with an inflatable swim bench that creates an element of instability that forces you to really activate your core, and you're lying in your normal swimming position on that bench. The height of the bench is designed such that you will be forced into a high elbow position as well during your swim stroke, so that you can work on technique as well as working on power and stamina. They've also created great coaching resources with example workouts and coaching tips on their website and social media channels. Check out the Zen8 Swim Trainer on zen8swimtrainer.com/TTS and get 20% off your order. And thank you to Roka that you can find on roka.com. Details matter when it comes to performance, and Roka know this, and this has led to some of their best innovations in a number of different product categories. For example, we have the arms up technology in the wetsuits and the trisuits that lead to maximized mobility throughout your swim leg of your triathlon. Another example is the angled lenses in the R1 goggles that make you not have to lift your head as much when sighting. And we have Geico anti-slip technology in their sunglasses, and eyeglasses is another example. These glasses just won't fall off your face no matter how hard you try. You can get 20% off your Roka order with the promo code that you can get on roka.com/TTS. Now let's get into today's question, which is from Evan, who writes, "Hi, I wanted to send a suggestion for the Q&A episodes. Maybe you could do a deep dive into FatMax training that I first heard about from the great podcast you did with Dr. Inigo San Milan. However, I thought more info could be given based on how you might find your FatMax swim, bike and run paces, but also then how much should you do as a percentage of your weekly training, and how might you design these sessions to fit in a training week? Please let me know what you think. Thanks, Evan." All right, Evan, thank you for your question. It is a very interesting topic, so happy to dig into it. I will tackle the question maybe slightly differently. I will first dig into it from the fundamentals of fat oxidation and fat max perspective, as we really need to establish what is known and what is not known about it before I can answer things like how to find the right intensity to train at, and how much to train at that intensity, and so on. So we'll circle back to some of your questions at the very end of the episode, but a lot of this will be just a general deep dive really into maximum fat oxidation rates and fat max. Before we do that, though, some background for listeners that have not heard the interview with Inigo San Milan. That was episode number 262, and I'll put a link in the episode description. Inigo San Milan is a coach and academic and physiologist, and he is the head of performance at UAE Team Emirates, and also the personal coach of several riders of the team, including Tadej Pogacar, who won Tour de France in 2020. So in the interview I did with him, he talks about doing a lot of zone 2 training and about generally following an 80-20 principle, with 80% of the training being zone 2 or even zone 1. He indicates that he does like a lot of his base training to be reasonably close to fat max, so at the higher end of zone 2 in his cohort of world-class cyclists, where fat max might be quite high. And I know that since that win of Tour de France 2020 by Tadej Pogacar, and him being coached by Inigo San Milan, a lot of people have become really interested in Dr. San Milan's coaching approach. And I loved how open and transparent he was about that approach in the interview, and have huge respect for that. And I do think that Dr. San Milan himself would be the first to say that there's no point trying to look for a single magic intensity, that this is exactly where to train because such intensities don't exist. If that was the case, he would tell his riders to sit on the trainer all day long and ride at that specific intensity, but they don't. They go out and ride in the mountains and things like that. So intensities vary. So I'll just put that out there right away. And I guess for me, two key points to take away from that interview are: one, that his principles of training are really great and we can all learn from them. And two, the exact implementation of the principles never matter anywhere near as much as adhering to the principles in the first place. So in other words, what I'm trying to say here is that there's no point trying to get overly in the weeds of what are the exact workouts or the exact intensities that are the best to train at, because such things simply don't exist. What is important is the mix of ingredients that form the meal itself, so to say, and not the exact ingredients themselves. But we do need to have a training strategy based on sound principles. So from that perspective, the principles laid out by Dr. San Milan are really fantastic. So definitely go and have a look and or listen to that interview in episode number 262. Now, let's define some terms so that we're all on the same page for the discussion that will follow. First, the first term to define is maximal rate of fat oxidation, or MFO. So it is what it says, the maximal rate at which you can oxidize fat. And usually we're talking about whole body fat oxidation here, at least when you have done this as a laboratory test and you have gotten an idea of what your maximum fat oxidation rate is. That typically refers to your whole body fat oxidation, so not just in a particular muscle group or anything like that. And the typical measurement of this is in grams per minute, so how many grams of fat can you oxidize per minute of exercise. And then we have FatMax, and FatMax is the intensity at which MFO, the maximum rate of fat oxidation, occurs. And typically, at least in the research, this is measured as a percentage of VO2 max. So for example, your maximum rate of fat oxidation could occur at a fat max of 60% of VO2 max. So when you reach an exercise intensity of 60% of your maximum aerobic capacity, that's where you're burning the most amount of fat in this example. But you could also, of course, convert that to more practical terms like power for cycling or speed for running. But it's important here to keep in mind that MFO, the maximum rate of fat oxidation, and FatMax are not the same thing. FatMax is at which intensity does MFO occur, and MFO is the fat oxidation itself. As many listeners probably know, the body uses a mixture of fat and carbohydrate for fuel when exercising, and the proportions and absolute amounts of carbohydrate and fats depends on several factors. But exercise intensity is definitely a key one. At low intensities, the proportions of fat will be very high. But eventually, at a certain intensity, which depends on the individual and their fitness level, it will go all the way down to zero. In terms of absolute amounts of fat oxidized, so here we're talking grams per minute, not percentage of total energy, the fat oxidation curve in endurance-trained athletes looks a bit like an inverted U. At least this is kind of the idealized version of it. In practice, it might be a bit different, but for argument's sake here, let's assume that typically the fat oxidation looks like an inverted U. This means that at very low intensities, fat oxidation is also low, simply because you don't need to produce a lot of energy at all. So you don't need to oxidize carbs, nor that particular high amount of fats. Then as intensity gradually goes up, still at fairly low intensities, but increasing intensities, you will have an increased demand for energy. And a lot of that is met by increased fat oxidation. So fat oxidation actually keeps going up as intensity goes up to that certain point where it reaches its maximum. And after that, it starts sloping down again and eventually reaches zero. Carb oxidation, on the other hand, is different. It is always increasing, although it's not linearly increasing. So at those very low intensities, it is quite flat very often and increases very modestly. But then eventually, this slope will start to get steeper and steeper. So we could almost say that it looks a bit like a hockey stick. So being rather flat at very low intensities, but very steep at higher intensities. So if you imagine this curve, this inverted U of how many grams per minute of fat is oxidized, your MFO, your maximum rate of fat oxidation, is the highest point on that inverted U. And the fat max is where on the x-axis, so at what percentage of VO2 max, or maybe even at what power or pace, does that MFO occur. All right, so those are the main definitions out of the way. Let's get into how FatMax and MFO can be determined. One seminal piece of research on determining FatMax and MFO was by Achten and colleagues in 2002, where they found that you can accurately establish FatMax and MFO with a graded exercise test. They used both step durations of 5 minutes and 3 minutes and found that even something as short as 3-minute steps was enough to get accurate results. They compared the fat oxidation values for these steps in the graded exercise test with having the participants then cycle for longer durations, so 35 plus minute constant load tests, and compared the fat oxidation during those long constant load tests with what it was at each step, each short step in that graded exercise test, and they found no differences. So they validated their own protocol in that way. So this is a test that can be done in a lab easily, but do note that a standard graded exercise test is not a valid protocol to really measure FatMax and MFO, simply because the standard graded exercise test that you do to assess your VO2 max and your ventilatory thresholds, for example, they have stages that are typically 1 minute or 30 seconds. So although they might give you information in the lab through that test on how much fat you oxidize at each of the stages in that graded exercise test, it can't really be used to say for sure that, well, this is your fat max or that is your fat max, because the stages are just a bit too short for that to be the case. However, in contrast to that validation of a fat max test protocol, we have a study by Schwindling in 2014 where they compared this kind of graded exercise protocol to find fat max with 1 hour constant load tests. And what they did was that they first had the participants establish their fat max and their MFO through that graded exercise test. And then they did 3 separate constant load tests, each of 1 hour long. And those 3 constant load tests were at the intensities that corresponded to the step where fat max occurred in the graded exercise test, and the step before, so a lower intensity, and the step after, so a slightly higher intensity. So 3 different intensities, but all kind of not too far from where fat max had actually occurred. And in those constant load tests, they actually found no significant differences in fat oxidation. Despite the intensities being different, and in the graded exercise tests, they had resulted in different fat oxidation rates, of course, and one of them was established as being the fat max. So from this study, at least, we can learn a couple of things. First, that fat max testing with a graded exercise test might be used to quickly and non-invasively monitor metabolic adaptations to training. But we cannot necessarily say that just because your fat max was, let's for argument's sake, say 0.6 grams per minute, that's necessarily going to be the case if you go and do ride for 1 hour at your fat max intensity. That's not something that we can directly establish based on a short graded exercise protocol. In other words, we can see, did you adapt to training based on if your maximum fat oxidation rate improved, or perhaps your fat max improved as a percentage of VO2 max, or just as an absolute power number. But what the fat oxidation rate is in the graded exercise test is not necessarily indicative of what your fat oxidation rate will be if you go out and ride an Ironman at that power, for example. So, and also the second thing we can learn is that training right at fat max is a bit of a misnomer. There is a relatively wide range of intensities that will get you reasonably close to your quote-unquote to your fat max or your maximal rate of fat oxidation. So we don't, again, we're not looking for a magic intensity here. There is a range where you are just oxidizing a lot of fat and that's it. And third, even though there weren't significant differences in the constant load tests of 1 hour in the study by Schwindling, the fat oxidation rate was actually the highest in the intensity that was a step below fat max from the graded exercise test. So from this, we can take a principle that I find applies in many other contexts as well in endurance sports, that shooting a little lower is much better than shooting a little higher. And this is something that I think applies in other contexts as well. For example, not least, where do you say that your threshold is, quote unquote, at least if you base your training off of that threshold, then this is quite critical to not estimate it to be too high. Estimating it to be too low is not a big problem. Slightly too low, that is, but too high can be a big problem. And while nothing really bad will happen necessarily by estimating your fat max too high, again, we see here that if it's important to you to find the accurate maximal rate of fat oxidation, then shooting too low might be the better course of action. Now, what about if you don't have a lab that you can go to test your MFO and your FatMax? Well, another option is to do an inside test, which, as you may know, you can do remotely just with your bike and your power meter, indoors or outdoors. And this will give you your MFO and your FatMax. One thing I do want to point out is that the MFO, there is your local rate of fat oxidation or maximal fat oxidation. So the maximum fat oxidation occurring in the working muscles when cycling, if you do the bike test. So compared to doing things in lab, where the lab measures your whole body fat oxidation, the numbers might skew a bit lower with the inside test. And that's not to say that one or the other is right or wrong, but it's important to keep in mind this difference so that you don't compare apples to oranges and compare directly an inside test result to a lab test result. What is great about the information you get through the inside test is that you get an estimation for your entire FatMax curve or your fat oxidation curve, and then you get a FatMax zone, which is a range of power numbers at which you will be very, very close to your MFO, give or take a few percent. But now, rather than saying that you have to go and ride at exactly 190 watts to be at your FatMax, you can realize that, okay, as long as I'm between 170 and 210 or so, then I'm in the right ballpark. So that's a big advantage. Finally, if you don't want to take any tests, but just want some rough guidelines, benchmarks to follow, ballpark estimates for endurance trained athletes, I would give you the following ranges on the bike to follow. So if your VO2 max is lower than 60, or perhaps if you haven't tested that, let's say more simplistically, that if your FTP is less than 4 watts per kilogram, then you should aim for 55 to 70% of FTP as your fat max zone. Whereas if your VO2 max or your FTP is higher than 4 watts per kilogram, then you can aim for 60 to 75% of FTP as your fat max zone. But I think it's important to point out here that when I say FTP, I mean a good estimate of your actual maximum lactate steady state. So put simply, something that you can hold for at least 40 minutes, ideally longer. If you're a beginner, then okay, holding for 30 minutes might be sufficient and it can still be your FTP. But if you have a couple of years of experience in endurance sports, then you really should be able to hold it for 40 minutes or otherwise pick a lower FTP number when basing your guideline calculations off of those benchmarks that I just gave. Another option that might be slightly more precise is to compare your heart rate reserve against your VO2 reserve. Now, you probably don't have a portable VO2 analyzer laying around for training, or testing for that matter, but there is some good research that we can use. And this research, which I'll link to in the episode description, shows pretty good correlations between heart rate reserve and VO2 reserve. In other words, if we can convert the typical normative reference value of fat max occurring at 60% of VO2 max for endurance trained athletes into what is that percentage of VO2 reserve, then we can target the same percentage of heart rate reserve as our training intensity target fat max, if you follow what I'm saying. So let's say you have a VO2 max of 60, and apologies, I'm going to be doing some calculations on the fly here, so you'll hear me typing. So if your VO2 max is 60, then, and we assume that your fat max occurs at 60% of VO2 max, then your fat max occurs at 36 milliliters per minute per kilogram, 0.6 times 60. What is 36 milliliters per minute per kilogram as a percentage of VO2 reserve? Well, the only thing we need to know for your to calculate that is, well, in addition to your VO2 max, which, by the way, you do need to know for this method to work, or you need to have a good estimate of it. So if you haven't done a test, then you could maybe use a software such as WKO to get a good estimate. So in this example, we are working off a VO2 max of 60. And what you need to know for VO2 reserve calculation is that we assume a resting VO2 of 3.5 milliliters per minute per kilogram. So then, we're also working off your estimated fat max of 36 milliliters per minute per kilogram. So we take 36 minus your resting VO2 of 3.5, and that is a that is 32.5. What we now need to do is to take 32.5 divided by the difference between VO2 max and resting VO2. VO2 max minus resting VO2 is 60 minus 3.5, so that is 56.5. So in other words, we take 32.5 divided by 56.5 and find that your fat max, which occurs at 60% of VO2 max, that equates to, in your example, 50 with, and again, this is because we're working off a VO2 max of 60, 57.5% of VO2 reserve. Now, the only thing we need to do is to find your heart rate reserve, the 57.5, or let's round up to 58% of heart rate reserve. Let's work off a maximum heart rate in the sport that we're looking at, let's say cycling, of 190 and a resting heart rate of 50. So then when we take 190 minus 50, we get 140. We take that 140 times 0.58, and that is 81.2, and we add that 81.2 to your resting heart rate of 50, and we get to 131 beats per minute as your target fat max heart rate. And this is all what we have. What we need here is we need to know your heart rate max and your VO2 max, or a good estimate of VO2 max. We need to know that, well, we need to assume a resting VO2 of 3.5 milliliters per minute per kilogram. And we need to know your resting heart rate, and we need to assume roughly 60% of VO2 max as your fat max intensity, which is on average a good estimate in endurance trained athletes. But I do want to reiterate here, fat max is a pretty broad range. If you use a standard training zone system, whether it's power based or heart rate based, and as long as you don't do something like overestimate your training zones or your threshold or whatever, then training anywhere in zone 2 will be pretty okay for fat oxidation. We don't have to make things too complex here. If you want to be slightly more precise than I might, and gun to my head, I would say that train in the middle of zone 2, and unless you are like a world tour rider. But for an amateur, train in the middle of zone 2. Don't go to the high end of zone 2 if you want to train at your fat max. I already gave some references here in terms of, for example, the 60% of VO2 max as an estimate for where fat max often occurs, but let's dig into some more normative values that we know from research. A really good reference paper here is a pretty recent literature review by Maunder and colleagues that I'll link to in the episode description, which is called Contextualizing Maximal Fat Oxidation During Exercise, Determinants and Normative Values. So the authors here reviewed publications that looked into fat oxidation in different populations, both athletes and non-athletes. And based on the available literature, they put together these normative values. So you can have a look at table 1 and table 2 in the article, which is open access, by the way. I'll give you one example here. The endurance trained male group had an average maximum fat oxidation of 0.52 grams per minute, and their fat max was 56% of VO2 max. Unfortunately, there was not enough data to make a group for endurance trained women, although the paper has groups for recreationally active women and overweight / obese women. Generally speaking, the trend is that women have a significantly lower MFO than men, but potentially a slightly higher fat max. Now, let's discuss a little bit how different moderators might impact both MFO and or fat max. And again, I will lean here on that 2018 review by Maunder, because it does a really good job of summarizing the research on these different factors. So look to that paper for more details. First, we have training status. So the researchers found five studies that compared fat oxidation between groups of different training status that might be well-trained or very well-trained, or it might be untrained versus active or whatever. But they have all shown that better trained athletes or more well-trained persons, so persons with higher VO2 max, have a greater MFO. However, FatMax doesn't seem to differ statistically significantly based on training status in most studies. What this means is that if you increase your VO2 max from, let's say, 50 to 60, you will probably see a significant increase in how much fat you can oxidize at maximum, your MFO, but also at sub-maximal values. So the amplitude of the entire fat oxidation curve will increase. But FatMax, so again, the point at which your MFO occurs, might not shift to a higher percentage of VO2 max. If it was at 60% of VO2 max before, it could still be at 60%, give or take, after. But of course, in terms of absolute power or pace, you will have seen an increase in fat max because you just increased your fitness. So 60% of VO2 max will occur at a higher power now or a higher pace. If it was at 160 watts before, now it might be at 190 watts. But again, when we say that fat max didn't change, it is the percentage of VO2 max didn't change. That is how this is reported in research. And it's also important to point out that training status is the number one moderator of fat oxidation status or fat oxidation ability. If you get fitter, then your fat oxidation will increase, and you will be able to oxidize more fat at higher power or pace outputs. So this is a crucial realization, because it means that we don't have to think too much about MFO and FatMax independently, but simply realize that it's tightly connected to your overall fitness, and improvements in fitness will result in improvements in fat oxidation. The next moderating factor is sex. Seven studies have compared fat oxidation between male and female athletes, or not athletes necessarily, but males and females, period. The findings suggest that absolute maximum rate of fat oxidation is greater in males than in females, as I said, and that is with a large effect size. However, fat max as a percentage of VO2 max seems to be greater in females than in males, although the effect size there is small. But interestingly, a couple of studies reported maximum fat oxidation rate relative to fat-free mass. And due to the fact that females carry more fat and less muscle than men, comparing absolute fat oxidation and MFO is not necessarily a fair comparison. So the two studies that reported fat oxidation, maximum fat oxidation relative to fat-free mass, they actually found that females had a greater maximum fat oxidation than males with this factor controlled for. And this finding aligns well with previous findings that at steady state endurance intensities, females have a greater relative energy contribution from fat. So in other words, as a percentage of total energy consumption, they use more fat than men do at a steady endurance intensity. However, it should be said also that these studies were done in non-athlete populations, in healthy but non-athletic populations. So we need to be a little bit careful with extrapolating the findings to endurance athletes. Next, we have nutrition status. And here we do know from only one study, but a good one, that what you eat right before, or 45 minutes before, I think, a FatMax test has an impact on your MFO and your FatMax. And this study, which is from Achten and Jochen Drup in 2003, they had trained male athletes performing FatMax tests on an ergometer after an overnight fast with either 75 grams of glucose or a placebo control ingested 45 minutes before the exercise. Maximum fat oxidation was 0.33 versus 0.46, and fat max was 52 versus 60% of VO2 max in the placebo, sorry, in the glucose versus the placebo controlled group. So the placebo group, which did not get glucose, they had higher maximum fat oxidation and a higher fat max compared to the group that ingested the glucose 45 minutes before the test. So a significant change. What should also be kept in mind here, though, is that maximum fat oxidation and fat max are not the only things that are impacted by acute nutrition. Your VO2 max in a fasted state is lower than it is in a fed state. And that is why when you go to a lab and do a VO2 max test, you are directed to have a good meal 3 hours before doing that VO2 max test in the lab. So in other words, even though in the fasted state, the study found that VO2 max occurred at 60% of VO2 max, if you were to compare it to the VO2 max from a test that was from a VO2 max test that was also done in a fasted state, then you might actually be back to the 52% that we saw in the glucose fed state, just because of the fact that VO2 max would be lower in that fasted state. So the point here is that there are big trade-offs to consider, like the reduced effective VO2 max and other things like increased likelihood of reaching a really low muscle glycogen state and reduced ability to perform high-intensity exercise, that you must weigh against any potential benefit of training in a fasted state. Is it worth it to reach slightly higher fat oxidation rates? Anecdotally, myself and other coaches, including here at Scientific Triathlon, we are really, really careful with fasted training because it's easy to overdo and the potential benefits often are quite marginal, to be honest. And personally, my rule of thumb is that if we do fasted training with an athlete, we limit it to once per week for the duration of a few weeks only. And this aligns well with also what you heard in many interviews with guests on the podcast recently and what people do in practice. So I think that it's important to have that disclaimer there. From a chronic nutritional perspective, there was a large study of more than 300 subjects, including both male and female subjects, that used a regression analysis to on four-day dietary records to see what the impact of nutrition was on MFO. And they found that 3.2% of the variation in MFO was accounted for by the carbohydrate and fat intakes that contributed negatively and positively, respectively, to that MFO. So 3.2% of the variation, that is pretty negligible, really. So that study definitely is not something that showed that chronic nutrition choices would have an impact. A famous study that a lot of you have heard of is the one by Volek in 2016, where they took ultra endurance runners and had one group on a ketogenic diet and another group on a high carbohydrate diet and tested their fat oxidation in a long treadmill test. And the maximum fat oxidation there was indeed a lot higher in the ketogenic group than in the high carbohydrate group, with 1.54 grams per minute versus 0.67 grams per minute. And the fat max occurring at 70% of VO2 max versus 55% of VO2 max. So here we can see that at the extreme end of the spectrum, with a ketogenic diet, you can see some big differences in both MFO and fat max. However, they also found that the muscle glycogen utilization during that long treadmill run was actually not significantly different between the groups. So what this indicates is that, well, the ketogenic group did not, in fact, spare any glycogen in their working skeletal muscle. They might have spared glycogen in the liver and elsewhere, perhaps, but in the working muscles, there was no sparing effect of glycogen. And since muscle glycogen is the factor that is contributing to fatigue and reduced performance rather than overall whole body glycogen content, that really seems to be a big, big problem with that. Even though you are using all this fat, if you're not sparing the glycogen in the muscles, then that's a potential issue. And that is something that we probably need more research to before we really explain what, why and what happened there. The next moderator is exercise modality. And here we're going to talk about running and cycling. And just briefly, in general, studies have found that there is a greater MFO during running compared to cycling. And FatMax, however, seems quite inconclusive, with some of the studies finding that FatMax is also greater during running, but others finding no difference between cycling and running. Then we have temperature, and there is some data to suggest that fat oxidation is reduced in high ambient temperatures and carb oxidation is increased. Also, in unusually cold temperature, there have been studies, but there is conflicting evidence there, with some studies reporting lowered carb oxidation and others increased carb oxidation compared to temperate conditions. So temperature is a moderator that we still need more research to really make sense out of. All right, so this was a pretty long background, but I hope that you found it useful. And now we're going to tackle the question of, which is essentially the gist of your question, what is the best way to train FatMax or train MFO? And train MFO, is it by training at FatMax, or what's the story here? So I'm still going to keep referencing some research here in terms of training intervention studies. Most training intervention studies that have investigated how MFO and FatMax change in response to training have been done in active or sedentary populations and not in endurance athletes. So again, we need to be careful with extrapolating all of this to already trained athletes. But all that said, what these studies have found is that MFO typically increases in response to training, while FatMax stays the same. So as I said, your FatMax remains at the same percentage of VO2 max, but that might mean that your FatMax power goes up or FatMax speed goes up if your VO2 max also goes up. There are some studies that have found increase in FatMax as well, but those are far fewer than the ones that have not. The type of training that has been done in these studies includes both steady aerobic training and different kinds of interval training. And both of these overarching types of training have been shown to increase MFO. Two studies, which are Al-Qahtani in 2013 and Lansi in 2015, actually compared steady aerobic training with high-intensity interval training, but did not find any differences in how much MFO increased between those two types of training. Both of those studies, however, were in overweight or obese populations, not in trained athletes. I will link to them in the show notes, and there are probably some other studies here that I have referenced and have forgotten to mention, but I will link to a lot of studies in the episode, sorry, not show notes, in the episode description in your podcast app. So from the literature, even for non-athletic populations where we have the research, we cannot say if there is a best way to train fat oxidation, but we can do so even less with athletes because there is just not any research done in athletes, or very limited research done in athletes. Another factor here that we should talk about is, what about training in a state of low glycogen? Well, there are a few good studies now coming out that have found that including low glycogen training in your program, so low glycogen training, just to recap for listeners that might not have heard of it before, is, for example, doing a high intensity workout in the morning, and then you don't eat carbohydrate really, you eat, but you eat mostly fat and protein, and then you do another workout in the afternoon, during which you have depleted your glycogen stores in that first workout, but without replenishing them in between workouts. So that is the second workout that is done in a state of low glycogen. And the theory is that this might be good for a number of reasons, including potentially increasing fat oxidation. And we have some studies here that show indeed that low glycogen training can significantly improve fat oxidation in athletes. Again, I'll link to a couple of them, Yeo 2008 and Halston 2010. But we need to look at this type of training as part of the overall training picture, and remember that it also has many drawbacks that we have talked about several times. So it is something to be used strategically and quite sparingly, in my opinion. Also, what these studies have failed to show is whether that fat oxidation actually translates to performance. So they have actually, in both of these studies mentioned, included time trial performance measurements, but despite the increased fat oxidation rate that have been found in the intervention group, they have not found a difference that to have a positive effect on time trial performance compared to the control group. And this might be related to what was found in the Volek study I talked about earlier, that even though fat oxidation is upregulated, it doesn't necessarily spare muscle glycogen, and in particular the intramyofibril muscle glycogen, which there is some indications might be the most responsible for reduced performance compared to other sites of muscle glycogen storage when that storage site is running low. And other than that, as I already said, we know that improved fitness and endurance capacity correlates with improved fat oxidation. So what we really need to concern ourselves with when it comes to training for improved fat oxidation is improving overall fitness and endurance capacity. And in doing so, we need to take a holistic view at the training program and not focus so much on the individual sessions. And when we do that, we come back to a few familiar principles. First, frequent, consistent training are massively important, the most important. And of course, overall training volume also has a very big effect on your overall fitness outcomes and your fat oxidation outcomes as it follows from that. Then the next principle is that you should have some hard sessions in there, but you should also have a lot of not so hard sessions in there. That doesn't necessarily mean just soft pedaling, but staying within zone 2 is a good guideline for those not so hard sessions. I would not say that there is any particular training intensity distribution that you have to follow. That will depend on the overall volume, the training, the sport, the modality, and the athlete's individual traits. But I would say that taking an 80-20 distribution as a starting point is definitely not a bad idea. If you're more on the low volume side of thing, let's say you're training 6 hours or less per week, then certainly it is entirely feasible that 80% low intensity becomes more like 70% low intensity, even 65 potentially. But whatever it is, you should have a number of low intensity sessions in there and a certain amount of time spent at low intensities, but without forgetting that the high intensity is important as well. And the moderate intensity, there are no gray zones in my opinion. It all depends on what your goals are and the specific demands of the race, your strengths and weaknesses, and so on. And bringing the question back to your referral to Inigo San Milan's training philosophy, so that philosophy certainly ticks all of those boxes. And sometimes the hard training, the hard workouts that his athletes do may not be hard in terms of intensity, because maybe it is the workout when they go out and do a 6 hour ride with 4.5 hours of that ride at 75 to 80% of FTP. That is what is the hard ride of the week. And that is a great session with a high stimulus of endurance adaptation. But is it a magic intensity for improving fat oxidation? I don't think so. I just think it's one of a number of good sessions, one in as a part of a whole holistic program that makes it work. So the way he structures his program means that it fulfills all the requirement of an effective plan. It has enough hard work in there, but it gives enough time and scope for recovery and adaptation. So striking that balance between training load and ability to recover from training, that is a key point here. Also, just to reiterate, if it turns out that training at close to your maximum rate of fat oxidation is actually important for improving your fat oxidation, then we do have a pretty broad range of intensities where fat oxidation is very close to max. So we don't need to be over precise. So the advice that I want to give here is that if you really want to find that intensity for yourself, then either A, test yourself with a proper testing protocol, as I described before, or B, use a standard zone system and do a lot of training in the middle of zone 2. I know you may have listened to the San Milan interview and thought, man, I'm going to start racking up rides at the high end of zone 2 or low zone 3 at 75 to 80% of FTP. But actually, unless you're a world-class athlete, the evidence I have seen, both anecdotally and in analyzing a lot of inside tests and in terms of looking at scientific papers and studies, it suggests to me that it is likely that your FatMax is lower than the high end of zone 2. It's more like mid zone 2 or even low zone 2 that would be a better target. So I'm not saying that those high CO2 rides are bad by any means. In fact, I think they are great. But it's not because it is exactly where FatMax is. Rather, I think it is because I do find that they are still rides that athletes can recover from pretty well. And they do get a strong stimulus when you ride at that intensity for a long enough time. So in an overall well-structured training plan, we can try to push the envelope of those endurance rides a bit with going at a higher intensity, higher zone 2 intensity every now and then, and get slightly more out of it compared to going at a low zone 2 intensity. But that all comes down to how the training program is structured. When you're approaching racing, for example, you would probably do way fewer of those because a lot of the workouts would be very intense and then the rest of the work needs to be very easy. But also for Ironman athletes, actually, if we're talking about Ironman training, then those high zone 2 rides fulfill the additional box of being highly race specific. So that's another great aspect of them. Now, I do want to address your question, Evan, of how much you should do as a percentage of your weekly training and how to design these quote-unquote FatMax sessions to fit in a training week. So I would say that for athletes training more than 7 hours per week, in terms of running and cycling, certainly I would recommend doing 75 to 90% of training in terms of time in zone 1 or zone 2, well, in a combination of zone 1 or zone 2. Most of that's probably in zone 2. Unless you're a really, really high volume athlete, then the higher volume you do, the more you do in zone 1. And all of that volume is going to be like not a great amount of distance away from your maximum rate of fat oxidation. It will all be shades of gray, so to say, but all of that will have you use fat and oxidized fat in your training. So that sort of base of low intensity training is important. And of that training time, I would distribute things all across the range, really. Again, it depends on your overall volume. But if you're kind of on an intermediate level of volume, then you might have a pure recovery day with just super easy zone 1 training. Then there is probably a bulk of your kind of steady, comfortable endurance training that is around your mid zone 2, whether we're talking running or cycling. And then you might have 1 to 2 workouts where we push the high end of zone 2. And this means that the intensity here, even within that low intensity zone, is split across many different baskets, so not all the eggs are in one basket, so to say. And again, there are no magic intensities, but if we make the program work as a whole, then generally you'll see fitness improvements, and as a result your MFO will increase, and as you get fitter, your absolute fat max in terms of power or pace number will also increase. How to fit them in a week? I'll give an example from an athlete I coach. This is a cyclist, and so it's pretty easy to overview because there's only cycling. Monday, only easy training and gym. So this is zone 1 we're talking about. Tuesday, hard workout, kind of a TT workout, threshold workout, and an easy ride. Wednesday would be a high zone 2 workout, a long high zone 2. So this is kind of your 75%, 70% or so. And an easy ride as well, so zone 1, so double ride a day again. Thursday would be an endurance ride with a little bit of tempo in it, so mostly mid zone 2, but with some clear zone 3 in there. Friday would again be an easy ride and gym, and Saturday another quality ride with some over-unders and some mid zone 2 work in there as well. And Sunday a long mid zone 2 mid or even low zone 2 ride. So that is how I have structured this week for this athlete. So as you can see, there is both those easy days with zone 1 on Monday and Friday. There is a lot of kind of mid zone 2 on the Sunday and low to mid zone 2 on Sunday and Saturday. And the Thursday ride, with the exception of the tempo, there's a lot of other easy riding as well on the double days, which is the Tuesday and the Wednesday. And finally, there is that high zone 2 ride on the Wednesday. So that is how I have gone about this particular program, just to give you an example. I hope that this helps, Evan. Keep in mind, the overall structure of the program is the most important. Don't get too in the weeds with the specifics of the workouts or the exact intensity. And this wraps up today's Q&A. I will have links to a lot of different studies in the episode description, but do check out the interview with Inigo San Milan if you haven't already, with this episode 262 on the podcast. And the review paper on fat oxidation is great by Maunder from 2018. It's called Contextualizing Maximal Fat Oxidation During Exercise, Determinants and Normative Values. Check that out if you want to. And keep sending in questions for future Q&As to michael@scientifictriathlon.com, and that's Michael with a K. If you're looking for coaching or training plans, go and check out what we have to offer on scientifictriathlon.com. We would love to help you reach your triathlon or endurance goals. Thank you finally to our sponsors, Zen8, that you can find on zen8swimtrainer.com. Use their swim trainer to improve technique, power, and stamina, even when you don't have time to go to the pool or pools are closed. You can get 20% off your swim trainer with the promo code that you can get on zen8swimtrainer.com/TTS. And thank you to Roka that you can find on roka.com. Check out their wetsuits, trisuits, swimskins, goggles, high-performance eyewear, and prescription glasses and sunglasses. And get 20% off your order with the promo code that you can get on roka.com/TTS. Thank you, as always, for listening. Keep training smart and keep loving triathlon.